Good morning, students. Today we'll start our next chapter, chapter 2, which is biological classification. In this chapter, we'll study about the different kingdoms of classification and how were they formed. So as we all know that to study the living organisms, we need to classify them because there are so many billions of species around us in the world. So it's very hard for us to study about them individually. That's why they are classified into some groups and categories. That means the classifying of the living organisms is done on the basis of their certain characteristics, and that's how they are kept in some groups. So the characteristics are the features or the quality which belongs to those particular organisms. For example, there are many organisms. Let's take an example of a bird, a fish, a human being, and tree. So like human beings, humans, fish, then bird, and tree. Okay, so all these four, these all are living organisms. Now, they have different characteristics. Like human beings are mobile. They can move from one place to the another. They undergo a heterotrophic mode of nutrition. Okay. Then fishes, they live on land. Okay. Then fishes, they swim in the water. And they don't have lungs. They have gills. Birds, they fly in the air. Okay, so they can fly. Fishes can swim. And trees, they are autotrophs. And they are immobile. So these, all these are the characteristics, features. So this is how, seeing the characteristics in other living organisms, we classify them into different categories and different groups. So that's how the classification is done. So Aristotle was a taxonomist. He was a Greek taxonomist. He was the first person to classify the living organisms. So Aristotle was the earliest man or the first person who tried or attempted to classify these living organisms on some scientific basis. Okay, so Aristotle's attempt to classify the living organisms. So what did he do? He classified the organisms on the basis of the habitats and other things. So he classified, Aristotle classified the organisms in generally two broad categories. Okay, number one was plant. And the other one was animal. So he generally said that there are two categories of the living organisms. The one is plant and the other one is animal. Now in this, he also then subdivided them. He classified them on the basis of three categories. Like plants, he took three different categories. So like he said that plants can be of three different types, which is herbs, then shrubs and trees. So the shorter plants or smaller plants were categorized as herbs, then the little middle order plants was as shrubs, and the bigger plants were on the trees. Then for the animals, he took certain characteristics, such as he classified the animals based upon the habitat. Okay, based on habitat, like where do they live. So like let's say he took the habitat as the land, then water and air. Okay, so the organisms living on the land were called as terrestrial organisms. And on land, aquatic. And the air, aerial. Okay, so also he also considered some other things, like in the animals, he considered blood. So those have blood were grouped in another, like presence of blood. So the organisms having blood were in one group, and those who did not had blood were in the other group. So two groups for the blood also. So now the Aristotle attempt was not very successful because it has many flaws. Like there are some animals which does not fall in the category of any of these habitat. Like some animals are there who live in land as well as on water. Like example, frog. Frog lives in land and also in the water. So it's not a complete terrestrial or completely aquatic, because when because frog lays their eggs in the water, and when the eggs hatches, they become tadpoles. So during that morphological state of tadpole, so they live in the water like fishes. They have their gills by then, but when they become adult, then they develop their lungs. This is how so these kind of animals were not grouped properly. So there were many other factors due to which this classification was not very successful. So then came a two kingdom classification, which was given by Carlos Linnaeus. Okay, so the two kingdom classification. Okay, so this was given by Carlos Linnaeus. Okay, so Carlos Linnaeus introduced a two kingdom classification, and this he was also called as the father of modern taxonomy. Okay, so again he classified the organisms on two groups, like because the name suggests it's two kingdom classification. That's why he gave the classification of kingdom Plantae. Again, he classified the organisms in two groups, kingdom Plantae, and the other one was kingdom Animalia. Okay, so even this classification, this mode of classification was not successful. So what was the basis of Carlos Linnaeus classification? So like he classified the Plantae as in the immobile, that the plants are immobile and they prepare their own food. So he said that all the organisms which are immobile and those who prepare their own food, so mostly autotrophs. So those who prepare their own food and are immobile were placed in kingdom Plantae, and all those who are mobile, those who have the modes of locomotion, and they intake their food and they intake their food by themselves, intake of food. Okay, so they were placed in another kingdom. So Carlos Linnaeus classified the living organisms into two kingdom, which is kingdom Plantae and kingdom Animalia, but it also did not work properly, so that's why it was not successful. So what was the reason for the failure of this Carlos Linnaeus classification? So there were many limitations in this classification. Like the example, Linnaeus did not distinguish between the eukaryotes and prokaryotes. Like all the organisms were placed in Plantae, so there are many plants which can be prokaryotes and which can be eukaryotes. Like if you take an example of immobile and mostly autotrophs, so fun, that the algae are immobile and they autotrophs, but some of them are prokaryotes and some of them are eukaryotes. Okay, so as again in Animalia, he said that all the organisms which are mobile will be animals, but sponges are animals, but they are immobile, they cannot move from one place to the another. So this is how there were many things which did not belong, many organisms which did not belong to any of those kingdoms, because there are many organisms like bacteria, fungi and viruses which do not belong to any of these kingdoms. Okay, so that's why this classification was also failed. Then came the another classification, mode of classification, another kingdom of classification, which was called as five kingdom classification. Okay, so five kingdom classification, which came in 1969, given by Robert Whittaker. Okay, so Robert Whittaker classified the life forms, the living organisms, into five kingdom classification. So he took some basis of classification, like he took many bases into which he classified. Some main criteria for the classification were the cell structure, okay, then body organization, then mode of nutrition. Mode of nutrition or the source of nutrition. Okay, so these were some main criteria into which the Robert Whittaker classified the living organisms. They are also given in your NCERT book. So we'll also take the help of the book. Okay, so like for example, here is a table in your book. It's all given here. So he took the characteristics like cell type, cell wall, nuclear membrane, body organization and mode of nutrition. So like in this, he classified all the organisms into five kingdom, called as kingdom Monera, then Protista, fungi, plantae and animalia. And the main criteria into which he classified the organisms were cell type. So we know that. Okay, before that I would like to explain you a little more about that, because we have already read all these in class 9th. But again, so if you remember, the cell are of two types. Okay, so that is prokaryotic cell and eukaryotic cells. So those cells which do not have a well-defined nucleus are called as prokaryotic cells. Okay, so in those cells there is no defined nucleus, so there is genetic material is just loose. They are not enclosed in a nuclear membrane. So those cells are the prokaryotic cells, which are not very well developed. And the organisms having the prokaryotic cells are also not well developed. And the eukaryotic cells are the cells which have a specific cell organelles, and they have all the organelles and nucleus in an enclosed membrane. So nucleus is enclosed in a membrane and they have other cell organelles. So they can be advanced cell. Now, so he defined the organisms into five kingdoms, which is kingdom Monera, five kingdom classification, which is kingdom Monera, kingdom Protista, kingdom Fungi, Plantae and Animalia. Okay, so first we'll study this. So all the prokaryotic cells, the organisms having the prokaryotic cells, were placed in Kingdom Monera. Okay, so he took the criteria of cell type, cell wall, nuclear membrane, body organization and mode of nutrition. So first, the first basic differentiating character was the cell type. So if they are prokaryotic cells, so all the organisms having the prokaryotic cell were placed in the Kingdom Monera. Rest the other organisms which were having the eukaryotic cell were placed in the other kingdoms. So the organisms having the prokaryotic cell were placed in the Kingdom Monera. Then comes the eukaryotic cell again. So he took that cell wall. So this Monera were having non-cellulosic cell wall, but in the protista the cell wall was present in some organisms. Okay, so like cell wall is present in the plants, we know that, but cell wall is absent in the animals. So they were the other things, but then he said that nuclear membrane. So nuclear membrane was absent in the Monera, but it was present in all the other four kingdoms. Now body organization. So the Monera and Protesta were, both of them were unicellular. Okay, though Monera and Protesta are differentiated between the prokaryotic and eukaryotic cell, but both of them contain a unicellular organisms. Like Monera are also single cellular and Protesta are also single cellular, but fungi, plantae and animalia are multicellular. Okay, so then mode of nutrition. So Moneras are generally they are autotrophs. They can make their own food or they can be heterotrophs. Okay, so all these Moneras, because the bacteria, the algae comes in the Kingdom Monera, so they can be heterotrophs, they can be saprophytes, or they can be also autotrophs. Then Protesta are autotrophs and they are also heterotrophs. Fungi can be heterotroph or saprophytic in nature. Plantae are autotrophs and the animalia are heterotrophs, saprophytes, or we can say that they all undergo the holozoic mode of nutrition. Okay, so this is how he differentiated all these organisms. Like again, Monera are the prokaryotic, these all we have read in detail in class 9 also. Protesta are the eukaryotic cell. I shall write in another page or here. So let's take the five kingdom classification. Okay, so first comes the Monera. Okay, so Kingdom Monera are the prokaryotes. And they are unicellular. Okay, then comes the Protesta. Okay, so they are eukaryotes, but they are also unicellular. Then comes the fungi. Now they are multicellular, and they are eukaryotic cells, eukaryotes, and they can be heterotrophs or saprophytes. Then comes Kingdom Plantae. They are again multicellular. And eukaryotic. And autotrophs. Okay. And then comes the Animalia. Which are multicellular then they are eukaryotes they are heterotrophic in nature they are heterotroph they can be saprophytes also and but the main thing is that they have the holozoic mode of nutrition okay so this five kingdom classification is the kingdom which we follow till date okay so we follow till date now let's study about these kingdoms along with these things the five kingdom classification was based upon the like I said cell structure body organization mode of nutrition or the source of nutrition so along with that there were one more thing which is called as phylogenetic relationship so phylogenetic relationship means on the basis of the genetic evolution that means he saw that which organisms are closely linked with another organisms or what are the mode of evolution so how are those organisms evolved so like we know that the bacteria are the primitive life the oldest life on the earth they are the oldest life forms on the earth and since they are the prokaryotic cells were the cells which were formed very first so all the living organisms were broadly classified into five groups and those groups were termed as the kingdoms so let's study the first kingdom which is the kingdom Monera okay so kingdom Monera okay so kingdom Monera is the oldest life form it's a primitive it's the oldest life form so they have prokaryotic cells that means they don't have a well defined nucleus they are prokaryotes okay so that means they have no defined cell organelles and nucleus okay and then they are unicellular that means they are made up of one cell and some of them are autotrophs some of them are autotrophs while others are heterotrophs okay so now autotrophs are those who prepare their own food so now autotrophs also are of two types that means now autotrophs tropic bacteria I must say because we are studying about the bacteria so kingdom Monera are the bacterias okay so bacteria they can be two types one is the photosynthetic autotrophs who will undergo the photosynthesis and other is chemosynthetic who will make their food by the chemical synthesis autotrophs okay and then the other one as heterotrophs which depend on the other organisms so they are of different shapes and sizes and they live many places like they inhabit in the soil in water they also are found in the radioactive waste And in the deep portions of the earth crust, they are found even in the deep oceans. They are found in the hot springs. They are found in snow, desert. There are so many places where life cannot exist. Like at a very high temperature, even at 100 degrees Celsius, also we may find some bacteria. Or sometimes we can find them in the frozen things like snow also. So bacteria are the most widely spread organism. That means they are, so they appear, I must write this. So they appear in variety of shapes and sizes That means they could be spherical, they could be cylindrical, they could be shaped in the of commas or spiral, and they inhabit it in many places. Like they inhabit in soil, water, in even the radioactive waste. In deep ocean, in hot springs, in snow, and even in the desert. Okay, so they also live in plants. They can also live in the animal body. In our body also, the bacteria are found. So they live in plants and animal bodies. Like we also have some bacteria in our body, good bacteria and bad bacteria, when we are infected with some bacteria. Okay, so these bacteria have a relationship of the mutual benefits to the organism. So they are like a symbiotic relationship. So because we have learned in our junior classes about the bacteria which fix the nitrogen to the atmosphere, they are helpful in the decomposition also. So they are beneficial for us as well, they are harmful for us sometimes. So there are types of bacteria. So we have four types of bacteria. Okay. So, types of bacteria. Okay, so we have generally four types of bacteria. So, number one is coccus. Number two is bacillus. Number three is Vibrium, and number four is Spirillum. Okay, so as the name suggests, the coccus is spherical. It's a sphere-shaped bacteria. It's a sphere, like round. Then bacillus is a cylindrical bacteria, it's like rod shape or like cylinder shape. Okay, then Vibrium is the coma shape, it's like coma shape, somehow like this. Okay, then the Spirillum is spiral shape, like this. So they are also given in your NCERT book. You can take a reference from the book. Is this cocci is a plural word and coccus is a singular word. Then bacilli is a plural word and bacillus is a singular word. Okay, so this is Spirilla and then it's a Vibrio. Okay, so all these are the different shapes of bacteria. And here these are the flagellum. With the help of those flagellum, they can move and they have their spores in them. Okay, so now we will be learning about the different types of bacteria in our next classes. So these topics will be covered in the next classes. So till then, I'll study those topics which I've taught you and practice the questions. Okay, thank you.